Hello and welcome back. This is our final lecture of Chapter 5. In this lecture, we will finish out Section 5.3 with a discussion on the CRISPR-Cas technology and end with Sections 5.4 and 5.5 on microarray and in situ hybridization techniques. CRISPR stands for Clustered Regularly Interspaced Short Palindromic Repeats, and represents a family of DNA sequences found within the genomes of prokaryotic organisms such as bacteria and archaea. These sequences are derived from DNA fragments of bacteriophages that have previously infected the prokaryote and are used to detect and destroy DNA from similar phages during subsequent infections. Hence, these sequences play a key role in the antiviral defense system of prokaryotes. This slide shows one of those repeating units of DNA, shown in blue, that's bound with one of the Cas proteins, shown in green and red. We'll talk in more detail about the Cas proteins and their function over the next few slides. Here is a diagram showing how CRISPR works to create adaptive immunity within the bacteria during the immune response to a viral infection. The CRISPR array contains some CRISPR-associated genes, or Cas genes, which encode proteins that will be used to recognize foreign DNA as it enters the cell. These Cas proteins will recognize the foreign DNA and cut small fragments from it. You'll notice that the CRISPR array also contains an AT-rich leader sequence followed by short palindromic repeats that are separated by unique spacers, shown in the square diagrams. The unique spacer regions come from these small viral fragments that are collected by the Cas proteins and are inserted between these clustered palindromic repeats. Small CRISPR RNAs are then transcribed from the repeat region and become associated with a second type of Cas protein complex. This Cas protein complex contains a helicase and restriction enzyme subunits. When it associates with these CRISPR RNAs, they can specifically target and bind with the infecting viral genome, where the helicase portion will unwind the genome and the restriction enzyme portion will cut it into small fragments that are no longer infectious. The viral fragments then remain housed within the chromosome of the bacterial DNA and serve as an adaptive memory to past infections. This causes faster immune response the next time the bacteria is exposed to a related bacteriophage. We have adopted parts of this bacterial immune system to make a gene editing tool that can be used in living cells to either inactivate or insert genes of interest. This can be used in human cells as well and holds great potential for the treatment of genetic diseases and disorders. Essentially, the Cas9 protein is used as a targeting and editing system. There will be a guide portion of single-stranded DNA or RNA that will help target the Cas9 protein in the genome. The homologous regions are shown in green. This is where the Cas9 endonuclease activity will mediate the cleavage of the host genome. This can cause the inactivation of a gene sequence if needed, or it can be also used to insert a new fragment of DNA as well. In the case of inactivation, the cleaved DNA is repaired using host repair processes such as non-homologous end joining repair. Whereas if a new gene is needed to be introduced into the genomic DNA, then a donor DNA that has homology in the region of the cleavage site will enable the incorporation of the new DNA through homologous recombination and repair. Note that later in the term, we'll come back to these DNA repair processes and go through these mechanisms in more detail. But for now, know that these mechanisms are possible and can be used to alter the genetic makeup of organisms, holding such great potential for advances in medical science. but also bringing about ethical concerns regarding its use for more cosmetic and/or skill-enhancing genetic alterations. CRISPR-Cas systems are also finding versatility in regulating gene expression as well. In these systems, the Cas endonuclease activity is inactivated so that it can no longer cleave the targeted DNA. The Cas protein can then be coupled with a transcription factor, such as activators or repressors, or even fluorescently tagged markers, such as the GFP protein. The guide system can then target the transcription factor to a specific location where it will temporarily affect the gene transcription within the neighboring regions. This also has a lot of potential for medicine, but is also a very powerful tool for research, enabling our ability to gain a deeper understanding of the biochemical regulation and cellular functions at play. And in fact, this technique has been deemed so important that the 2020 Nobel Prize in Chemistry was recently awarded to the two researchers that have had fundamental contributions in elucidating this pathway, Emmanuel Charpentier and Jennifer A. Doudna. And that brings us to section 5.4, where we will learn more about DNA microarrays and their use in biochemical research. So what exactly is a DNA microarray? A microarray is a biochip where a collective of microscopic small single-stranded DNA spots are attached to a solid surface. Here they are covalently cross-linked. Scientists use DNA microarrays to measure the expression levels of large numbers of genes simultaneously, or to genotype multiple regions of a genome. Each DNA spot contains picomoles, 10 to the negative 12 moles, of a specific DNA sequence known collectively as sequence probes. Target sequences can then be hybridized with the probe sequences to yield a signal. Signals are usually generated with a fluorophore marker that is activated once the labeled target has been allowed to hybridize, and then excess is washed from the system. Here is an example of what can be done with microarray technology. This experiment is a dual-color microarray where messenger RNA is isolated from two different cell samples from the same patient, representing cancer cells and normal cells. Each sample set are labeled with a different fluorescent marker. In this case, the cancer messenger RNA is labeled with a red fluorescent probe, whereas the normal messenger RNA is labeled with a green fluorescent probe. Thus, green will indicate gene expression at the loci in normal cells, whereas red indicates gene expression in cancer cells. Yellow color and orangish color represents gene expression in both samples. Thus, this can provide a starting place for analyzing differential expression of gene targets within
Here's
different
an example
samples
of what can
and
be done
to
with
determine
microarray technology.
Places within tumor cells where transcriptional regulation has gone awry. Microarrays can be used in many different types of experiments that involve hybridization of small probes. This is just one example. And in our final section, we will learn more about in situ hybridization with nucleic acid probes. In situ hybridization using nucleic acids seeks to evaluate expression and localization of specific messenger RNAs within an organism, an organ, or a cell type, depending on the mode of analysis. The key technique currently in use includes in situ hybridization to messenger RNA with oligonucleotides and RNA probes, either radio-labeled or hapten-labeled. Analysis with light and electron microscopes are used to detect the oligonucleotide probes after they have bound to the messenger RNA within a sample. For hybridization histochemistry, as shown here, sample cells and tissues are treated to fix the target transcripts in place and increase access of the probe. Solution parameters such as temperature, salt, and detergent concentration can be manipulated to remove any non-identical interactions, such that only exact sequence matches will remain bound. The probe is then either labeled with a radioactive, fluorescent or antigen-labeled basis and is localized or quantified within the tissue using autoradiography, fluorescence microscopy, or immunohistochemistry, respectively. And with that, we will conclude our discussions of DNA techniques.